Hello, I'm Emily Abbott from the American Chemical Society. Welcome to this media briefing from ACS Fall 2022. What do kitchen sinks, taillights, diapers, and gummy bears all have in common? Are you stumped? Carbon. And to top it off, these products can all be made from a new resin that scientists have developed to make sustainable wind turbine blades. According to the Global Wind Energy Council, in 2020, there was a 53% growth in new wind power installations worldwide from 2019. Wind turbines are massive and they're getting bigger. The problem is that the mechanical part can outlive the blades, and current blades are disposed of in landfills, which is counter to the sustainable attractiveness of wind energy. A team has developed a new resin that can be used to make turbine blades, and when the blades hit their lifespan, the material can be dissolved in a polymer and converted into other consumer materials, all because of the carbon commonality. We're joined today by Dr. John Dorgan, the primary investigator of the study from Michigan State University, to talk more about his team's research. Thanks for joining us.
Well, hi, Emily. Thanks for having me. It's my pleasure to be here.
Thank you. So what inspired you to study renewable resins for wind turbines? Was it the resin, the wind power? Walk us through your journey.
Yeah, well, I have a long history working with a polymer known as PLA or polylactides. And I started that probably in the early 1990s or so when I first started working as a college professor. And the original applications for PLA were in biodegradable, sustainable packaging. Can also be used, though, interestingly enough, as a fiber for making textiles and clothing. And so I was quite familiar with that particular polymer. And as we were funded by the Department of Energy to start looking into making wind turbines in more energy efficient ways, and how could that be done? It was sort of a natural progression, a natural evolution for me to think about, you know, how could my favorite polymer, how could PLA potentially be used in this application? And so we started thinking about that. And I think some of the ideas we had turned out to be pretty good ones. And so we were able to actually make some wind turbines that have a lot of end of life options that the current materials that are used just simply, you know, it's not possible to do the same things with them.
Can you walk us through the various stages of the cycles of the composite, the upcycling, recycling, and downcycling?
Yeah, well, I think if you take a look at the figure that's in my abstract, we have a material which is embedded with fibers to make a strong fiberglass, such as the piece I'm holding here. And what you can see with these materials is there's a polymer that sort of surrounds and embeds the fiber. So we can take this and we can actually dissolve it in what's known as a monomer, a fresh monomer. And that will actually dissolve out the polymer. And I can then use that material and recast the next generation of wind turbines. So that's, you know, the holy grail in polymer recycling is always to go from the same application back to the same application. Oftentimes you'll hear this referred to as bottle-to-bottle recycling. So we actually can do that with these materials. We've gone through several cycles and we've shown that the mechanical properties can be sustained. Now, there's certain cases where maybe you wouldn't want to do that, you know, make the material available for other applications. And so, you know, we talk about the recycling, it's back to the same product, but you can also economically downcycle into something that would be worth less money on a per pound basis. Sometimes you may just be forced to do that depending on local markets, or you can upcycle into things which are actually more valuable. And so with this new resin material that we've developed, all three options are available to us. We can do the recycling as I've mentioned, but you can also just simply take the material and shred it up and then maybe add a little bit more polymer to it. And then you can injection mold and make things like, oh, maybe computer housings or, you know, various consumer goods, you know, speakers or a blender in your kitchen, whatever you have. I mean, injection molding is a very common manufacturing methodology. And so really the nice part of just grinding it up is that you have the glass fibers in there to reinforce the material. So we're really going into a well-known type of commodity material, short glass fiber, reinforced plastics, big markets for that. So we're confident that these materials could be sold into those secondary markets. So that's just doing mechanical type processing, but we've also developed a number of approaches for doing chemical modifications to the materials as well. And specifically, we can actually digest out one of the components, the PLA polymer, using just a simple base, like an alkaline solution. You know, think of baking soda or baking powder in the kitchen, something very quite mild in terms of its chemical activity. And when we do that, what's nice is that the polylactide breaks down into its monomer lactic acid, which is a natural metabolite, quite environmentally benign. And we can recover the polymethyl methacrylate, which is also present in the material. And so now we have a material that can be used for all kinds of applications. I mean, polymethyl methacrylate, or PMMA, is what is commonly known as plexiglass. So, you know, we can think about making the types of barriers that you may have run into during the COVID epidemic. There's another large market is in taillights for automotive manufacturing. So we're able to digest one polymer, recover the other polymer, use it for different applications. And then from that monomer that's coming out, the lactic acid, we were actually able to purify that through distillation and actually make food grade lactate. And so this is something that you would find in like Gatorade sports drinks or in various types of candies. And so we went that extra step and took the recovered material that we made and turned it, you know, included it as an ingredient in some candies. And so we made gummy bears from that. And one of the other things that comes out of this is if you digest a little bit longer in that base, you can convert the polymethyl methacrylate to polymethacrylic acid, which is actually the polymer that's used as a superabsorbent in baby diapers. So we really have, as you can see from the diagram, you know, we really have a wide variety of choices for what to do with this material at the end of life. And I think this is really one of the keys, you know, like how do we design molecular flexibility into our materials so that, you know, it's great to be able to go back, you know, to what the same thing that you made, but who knows, maybe over the 30 years of the wind turbines, you know, the design for that, you know, changes radically. And now you want to use the material for something else. So I think this idea of molecular flexibility, being able to, you know, move carbon from one type of carbon to another type of carbon is perhaps the big idea here, which I hope, you know, people can really appreciate and catch on to. I remember as a child, you know, I was influenced by science fiction, as you might expect for a technology person. And I remember reading an article by the famous author Isaac Asimov, where he talked about the future and we would just have, you know, neutrons and protons and electrons, and we'd be able to resynthesize them in any type of way that we want. So that, I think that maybe has been in the back of my psyche for a long time, and wanting to be able to transmute, if you will, carbon into different types of forms. It's almost like the replicator, if you think of Star Trek, right, where they can just sort of make atoms into anything that they want, ice cream floats or new clothing or what have you. And so those are the motivations for what we're doing, I think. Of course, we're a long ways from the replicator idea, but you know, we did draw some inspiration from those types of things.
Are there other applications that this kind of research could be extended to? So much plastic is used to manufacture a car or kids' toys. How could someone put your thought process to work to avoid those products ending up in a landfill?
Well, the answer to that is absolutely. I mean, there's a wide variety of you know, consumer and industrial goods that could be produced. I mean, you know, we're working with a broad class of materials known as unsaturated polyester resins, and they're broadly used for all kinds of applications. One that we're particularly excited about are so-called engineered stone products. So these would be familiar to you if you have kitchen countertops or in hotels and motels. Oftentimes there's a marble-esque type of stone countertop in the bathroom of hotels and motels. And all of these are in the category of engineered stone products. And so just for demonstration purposes, we made this little logo, school logo. We're the Spartans, so go green, go white. This is a little green, Spartan green logo that we made out of this stone type of material. But we've also gone beyond that, made a variety of different samples and tested to make sure that they have the appropriate thermal and physical properties for these applications, and applications like kitchen countertops. And in fact, we've actually gone and cast this full-size bathroom sink. So I think you can see that the materials that we're putting together are really quite practical and wide-ranging in their application. You mentioned automobiles too. In addition to making fiberglass, we can make carbon fiber materials, which is sort of the future for lightweighting vehicles as we move towards greater electrification of the vehicle fleet. There's great incentive to try to make lighter weight vehicles. And of course, carbon and other fiber type reinforced materials is a way to do that. And we think it would be great if, you know, these types of molecular systems were deployed in those types of applications as well.
Great. So what's next? How will you continue your work with this study?
Yeah, well, we're in discussions with some of the companies and the manufacturers of the engineered stone products. One of the issues we face with the wind turbines is that the wind turbines are so large and consume so much material that this specialty polymer, the polylactide, it would be difficult to get enough polylactide to really build all the wind turbines that we're currently building. Whereas the engineered stone products, the amount of resin which is used is a little bit more modest. And we also think that from an environmental perspective, where people are remodeling sort of on a 5-year type time frame, that it probably makes more sense to go in that direction with the resin materials.
Great. Well, thank you so much, Dr. Dorgan, for sharing your research with us today.
Well, thanks for having me on. It's been a pleasure.
Be sure to check out our other media briefings for ACS Fall 2022, which will be posted throughout the meeting at www.acs.org/ACS Fall 2022 briefings.